Welcome to Black and Gold Digital Edition, a behind-the-scenes look at your Pittsburgh Steelers.
Hi, and welcome to week 8 of our digital show. I'm Jay Pushkar alongside Ken Urbanski and Mike Fenner. And guys, the Steelers were snake bitten yet again, this time in Miami, losing 16-10. Just when they started to get some momentum coming off a big win against Tampa Bay, they fall short in South Florida. And Kent, what can you take away with it? In fact, that both teams didn't score in the second half. The Steelers looked like they had something going and then just made a lot of mistakes down the stretch.
Yeah, tough game to watch, you know, if you're a Steelers fan. It's there, you know, it's tempting. They're tempting you, and then they just, you don't get the treat at the end. I really was impressed how the defense responded, though, and shutting that offense down when they really came out, you know, with all guns a-blazing and just driving down the field like they were on the Steelers. And I thought there was going to be a blowout in the making. But credit to Steelers defense. They made the adjustments. And, they made Tua look a little rusty in the second half, you know. So I mean, he was missing on plays and missing on passes. And credit that secondary for batting a lot of those passes down. But they really needed to capitalize on those interception opportunities to put the offense in a better position to score, and they just didn't do it.
And Mike, offensively, we've seen it all season long so far. Whether it's Mitch Trubisky or Kenny Pickett at quarterback, they're moving the ball between the 20s. They just can't finish drives. And in this case, they really couldn't get Chris Boswell in the game as well to generate some points either. But they're just not finishing drives. Is there a way that they can correct this?
Just got to stick with it. I don't know. Yeah. I mean, and even Kenny Pickett now is coming out and saying, like, you know, you got to drop some better stuff. I don't think he's trying to throw his offensive coordinator under the bus, but he's saying, like, these guys aren't just going to be able to run by everybody, especially quality secondary players on the other side of the field that made the plays, that made the three interceptions while Pittsburgh dropped the four interceptions. These guys aren't just going to be able to run by people. You got to scheme them up a little bit better, and, you know, we'll see what happens. It's I don't know. It's tough right now because a lot of people want to put it solely on the offensive coordinator, and these players are making the comments that kind of go along with that.
We're hearing all these, you know, guys on a national level talking about this offense being so simplistic and high school-like even. Mm-hmm. That's pretty harsh, you know. So, and then they're saying things like George Pickens is only running certain kinds of routes, real generic routes, and he's capable of more than that. So maybe that's what they're talking about there, what Kenny's referring to there, they got to open up the playbook a little bit and make that a little bit more difficult of an offense to defend than what you're seeing now.
You mentioned that it was a tough watch, but what impressed me was that final drive for Pittsburgh. I mean, no timeouts. There was less than 2 minutes to go in the ball game. They needed a touchdown to not only tie, but maybe take the lead with the point after. And Kenny just was able to go down and looked calm doing it.
He's been
unfortunately
able to do
through
that.
The pick at the goal line, but they were there to possibly win it.
Yeah, I was, you know, and that's the one game that we weren't at this year, but I'm sitting there watching it and just saying, run the ball. run for the first down, and then you got a first down and four more chances to get in the end zone. But that's easier said for people sitting on the couch and then someone making a split decision like that. So hopefully going forward, you know, he learns from those mistakes and knows when to use his legs, when to not, and when to throw passes, and when to just throw it away.
I was hoping that they would generate that game-winning drive just to stick it to Miami for the analytics aspect, because they could have kicked a field goal in the third quarter and go up 9.
I know you're a big fan.
And they never had to worry about it. Oh, boy, we have long road trips and discussions about analytics. Meanwhile, speaking of numbers, the Philadelphia Eagles, the only undefeated team left in the National Football League. That's who Pittsburgh has coming up this week. Just your take, Mike, on just how Pittsburgh's been preparing. You were down at practice on Wednesday. The overall vibe, how they feel going into this matchup.
You'd have to think they're going to come in loose, another double-digit, you know, underdog-type scenario for this team. But they've got to come in and think, like, hey, this team's got to lose at some point, right? Why not us? Why can't we be the team to knock them off? You look at the 6-0 start for the Eagles. They're coming out of the bye. That's not ideal for Pittsburgh because they're well-rested, Philadelphia that being. They only have a couple really quality wins, though. Dallas, I believe Minnesota, maybe Arizona.
They
you
played
debate
Arizona
that, but
tight, though. I mean,
exactly. Yeah, so I'm not sure it's not a total mirage in terms of the quality of teams. I mean, the NFL, it's hard to beat anybody. But at some point, the luck's got to run out. I mean, you got the Phillies in the World Series, you got the Eagles undefeated. Something has to give here. They can't just win forever, right? So, I don't know. Another interesting thing is Kenny Pickett being talked about as, you know, being a huge Philadelphia sports fan as a kid. I think he's really enjoyed kind of the fanfare with that. Growing up as an Eagles fan, you saw some photos surfacing on social media about, you know, him in Eagles jerseys, big Donovan McNabb fan. And so I think he's going to really enjoy that experience of going across the Commonwealth, playing against the team he grew up rooting for, with a chance to pick up a huge quality win for his new team now.
Well, on the flip side too, Jalen Hurts playing for the Eagles, but also his baseball rooting interest is the Houston Astros.
Sure, yeah. So I mean, against the Phillies.
Neither quarterback going into this week is going to have any anything positive really say about their teams and who they represent. But Kent, the way Pittsburgh has played this year, if you exclude the Buffalo game, they've been in every game.
Yeah.
If they can just generate anything north of 20 points, it's got to be road of possibly getting back on the road and winning some games.
Right. Well, listen, they're last, I think, in every statistic offensively, right? Like 30s, ranked 31st in yards per game and points per game. That needs to change. You know, this weekend they need to, you know, turn those statistics in their favor a little bit. And that's going to be a tough ask, you know, with the solid defensive backs that they have there. And with the Eagles, but I think you see the progression with Kenny, and this is a process. Let's be realistic there, you know. But for him, he doesn't seem to be, you know, fazed by going into the different stadiums that are, you know, hostile environments. He seems to keep remaining as calm, and he needs to do that here. I like their chances coming in here. And I think they can catch, you know, the Eagles, you know, maybe with shaking a little rust off from coming off of a bye. And, you know, let's see what happens. They got to establish a run, and they got to get some pressure on a quarterback. They did. There's no sacks in, the last couple of games with them. That's you know, you can't let Jalen Hurts just stand back there and pick you apart, you know, and he's good with his legs, too. So, but, you know, we're talking about another quarterback that didn't get off to a real good start. You know, it took him a while, so.
I think we forget as football fans is that we have to have patience. I mean, look at Josh Allen in Buffalo. Look at Jalen Hurts now in Philadelphia. Kenny Pickett's going to be in that same company because you got to have the pieces around you, too.
Right,
it's all
got
to come together. And then just having that season quality of playing 2 or 3 years, we're thrusting a lot of these guys into the lineup.
Sure.
And already crowning them Hall of Famers before they really make any significant impacts.
Yeah, there's you know, when you look at this offense, you know, there's I don't think there's a starter in there over, 28 years old or something like that. It's a really young offense. So, you know, give them, you know, I think each game, like you said, they're not getting blown out by anybody. So other than in Buffalo, I like them to go up there and represent. I think it's going to be a great football game to be at.
On the other side of the ball, Mike, you had a chance to see T.J. Watt start to take more significant snaps and reps at practice. And how encouraging is it to see number 90 back out there getting close to being maybe not quite 100%, but pretty close to it with that torn injury?
Yeah, that window's open now, the 21-day return to play window. And we saw him put the helmet on, strap it up, hitting the sled a little bit, doing some individual drills. It's encouraging, and I'm sure it gives these guys on that side of the ball a huge lift just to see him out there, how hard he's working to get back, knowing how much it means to him, and the fact that his season is not over after those fears from week one in Cincinnati. I know a lot of people were wondering, man, is he going to be back this year? And the fact that we're already seeing him and seeing that you know, tangible evidence on the practice field that he's going through individual drills, he's got a chance to get back. You've got this week, obviously, you're not going to have him play. You get the bye week. And so within that window, you would hope, you know, maybe that New Orleans matchup, maybe the Cincinnati game, we'll see how he progresses. And, you know, you just got to hope that this team can stay in that AFC North hunt until they get him back. And then once he's back, he could really make a huge difference for this team and maybe try to help on that stretch run.
And what's crazy is that even though they're 2-5, nobody's running away with the AFC North.
Exactly.
So if you can steal one more victory before the bye, it might be the shot in the arm that they need moving into the second half of the regular season.
And the back end of that schedule, I like it. You know, I mean, and everybody's going to, a lot of opportunities there. A lot of teams deal with injuries just like the Steelers. So, you know, there's a lot of football left to be played.
No question about it.
Four division games.
Yeah.
I mean, that's right there. That's going to catch you up if you win them.
Especially coming out of the bye, they're going to have back-to-back home games.
Right.
And then they go on the road against Indianapolis, in which, you know, they're struggling. So, like you said, there's some winnable games out there, but they first have to get themselves corrected and see what they can do in week number 8 against Philadelphia. All right, fellas, thank you so much. For Mike Fenner, Ken Urbanski, I'm Jay Pushkar. Thanks for tuning in. We'll talk to you next week.
Thanks for watching. Join us again next week for Black and Gold Digital Edition.